What is going on, everybody? Welcome to my channel, Geode Cracker and Collector here, and today we are going to be learning about a special type of geode. It doesn't form everywhere and you can't find it in every creek, unfortunately, but these things are really, really cool. There's so many different variations you can find of them. I've found quite a few, as you can see. I'm going to be showing you guys a handful of examples today, and we are going to be looking at geodized fossils. And if you're not familiar with that term and you've never heard about it before, there's going to be a lot of information coming, so make sure you pay attention. Hopefully teach you a thing or two today about geodized fossils and why they're so awesome. So without further ado, give me a second. We're going to get over here and I'm going to start laying some information on you. So I hope you're ready. So before we dive too deep into the geodized fossils today, I'd first like to briefly talk about geodes and about the two ways that we know that they can form. First off, a geode by definition is a round or rounded rock that contains a crystal or mineral cavity inside. And that's pretty much all I want to share on that for now. And like I said, there are two definitive ways that we know that they can form. First off, and the typically more favorable type for collectors, are igneous geodes. And as the name implies, these geodes form as a byproduct of volcanic eruptions both on land and at sea. During those eruptions, gas bubbles get caught in rapidly cooling lava, leaving behind perfectly, or sometimes not so perfectly, round cavities. And later on, these cavities are present for mineral-rich waters to seep in, and over time that water evaporates, and based on what minerals are left inside, we have crystals that form. Which leads me to the second type of geode, and the kind that we're going to focus mainly on today, which are sedimentary geodes. And as their name implies, these geodes are found and formed in layers of sedimentary rocks, like limestone and shale. Similar to igneous geodes, these form primarily when similar gas or air pockets get trapped in mud or soil that then turns to sedimentary stone, and through the same process as the igneous geodes, mineral-rich waters will seep in and evaporate, and over time, crystals will form based on what minerals are present in that water. But there's also something else that these sedimentary geodes can do, and it's pretty funky. Enter geodized fossils. These wacky geodes don't form in gas and air bubbles like their relatives. Instead, they take on the shapes and impressions left behind by organic matter, also known as fossils. And most of the time, the fossils that we see are actually impressions or casts left behind by whatever was trapped there long ago. Because most organic material will decay, leaving cavities with perfect impressions of what it once was. And normally, silica finds its way into these cavities and hardens, and that's what we end up finding thousands, if not millions of years later when we collect fossils. And that's the life of a fossil, unless these fossils are also in an area that's prime for sedimentary geodes. Then we have a chance to get the best of both worlds. All right, I think that's enough talking about them. I think it's time we head on over and check some of these things out. And all right, so this is just a small amount of the geodized fossils specimens that I have here in my collection. These are some of the nicer ones, some of the ones that are a little bit more obvious to tell that they were once a fossil, and a handful that I've actually been able to formulate an educated guess as to what type of crinoid or brachiopod or horn coral or what have you the specimen actually is. So I'm going to do my best to have some of those photos up on the screen for you guys that show what the fossil looked like on one side and the geodized fossil on the other side to kind of give you a better idea, because me just picking this up and saying, oh, this is part of a crinoid, some of you may understand, some of you may not. So I did my best to try and make some visual aids to help along the way. But in case all that information we learned about earlier in this video didn't quite cut it for you, I still have a little bit more of a visual representation to show you guys what I mean. So let's start off with some of these horn corals. So these, as you can see, have some definition left. This is probably the least impacted by secondary mineral growths that I've found. And then these next ones here, you can see we have a microcrystalline form of chalcedony known as beakite that grows, but these are horn corals. And as we can see, even with the beakite, we could still see some semblance of those lines, of those ridges, even when we look inside. Those lines are through and through with these horn corals. Now, when we look at something like this, it becomes a little more apparent, like, okay, we've got a little bit of a thicker side, a little bit of a thinner side, you know, there's kind of a taper. This definitely looks like a horn coral. And then when you look on this side, there's a whole geode sitting right there. And for some reason, I find a tremendous amount of geodized horn corals that have this little nub of a geode on there. So I'm curious if that has something to do with how these horn corals actually grew. Maybe it was some sort of barnacle that attached to it and just came along for the ride. But maybe that still doesn't cut it for you. Maybe that's like, okay, it could kind of be. Maybe that's a horn coral. Well, I've got the happy medium. I've got a horn coral right here that is on its way to becoming a geode. Like we can see there, a little bit of that epicite left. And then we can see those lines. Even though down here, looking at it this way, if you didn't know, it just looks like a geode. Even though this fossil is on its way to becoming a geode, we can still see those lines there. So that's our indicator when we got ourselves a horn coral. And then you ask, well, what about the crinoids? Well, we've got a nice crinoid stem. No obvious silica replacement. This could be a whole silica replaced fossil itself, but nothing that looks like it's on its way to becoming a geode quite yet. Same thing with this guy. Hope that one's rolling away. Same thing with this guy. Still even has a little bit of host rock on it. But then we have ones like this, where there's very little definition left. And when we look on the sides, that has definitely been replaced by silica. But then you're like, well, Tyler, how do I know? How do I know that's still a crinoid? How do I know that's a geode? Well, because we can find some that look like this, that are literally in the process of being blown up by the geodes that are forming inside of them. And then we have ones like this. One side looks kind of like a geode. Even the bottom of it looks like a geode. And then we have the other side. Look at that. There's a crinoid. And that one is almost perfectly split down the middle. Half replaced by silica. Half of it still clinging on to its life as a crinoid. And maybe that's still not enough for you. And that's where the rest of these come in. And I've got so many things here. I wish I could spend a whole bunch of time on each one of these, but I'm going to kind of breeze through some of them. Some of them I'm not even going to pick up, but this corner over here, that is a giant horn coral. Now, I do not understand, scientists don't understand, and other collectors like me still don't quite understand how a fossil that can start off that size can somehow grow to be that size, because we're not finding the regular fossils that big. We're finding the geodized fossils are winding up that big. So there's still a lot of uncertainties that come along with these things. And then we have things like this, which this is a platycrinites, which is a coil spiraled, whatever you'd like to call it. I think it looks like a DNA strand. So this is a crinoid, just like this is a crinoid. So just like this has the segments there, this would attach to the bottom of the seafloor. The stem would go up, and then on top of it would be the crinoid calyx and then the head, and it was basically a starfish on a stick. So is this. This one is a little bit more geodized, but then we find little examples like this where we can tell it's definitely the same thing, but this piece here is on its way to becoming a geode. Really, really cool. And then we have things like this, another section of a crinoid. This was probably a calyx because we can see that those 5 points there, always apparent in geodized crinoid calyx or crinoids heads. And we can still see those segments of the crinoid still trapped inside of there. Which leads me to this guy right here, one of my absolute favorite finds. You can see the lines of the crinoid segment all throughout there. Obviously that crinoid looks huge compared to some of these. Now, maybe that was a species that was that big. I believe that it's been exploded like we've seen in a couple other examples so far. It's been exploded by the whole geode forming process, but this one's pretty neat. Notice the lines of that crinoid and check out inside. We have lines of botryoidal chalcedony that are just rings that follow one after another, just like those crinoid segments did. And we even have little Indian beads is another name for them, but little crinoid segments just all over the place. That is one of my absolute favorite finds, one of my absolute favorite geodized fossils. And kind of wrapping it up with the crinoid things, we have this geode here. Very obviously has a crinoid running right through it. This here is an example of a geodized crinoid calyx or crinoid head. We see those five stars. Something like this will be a little bit harder to identify. But this guy right here, if you pay attention to the screen, I believe I've determined what this one is. And if you look on the screen, I'm not going to try and butcher that name, but I believe that is the species of crinoid that I have here. Because if I take these two photos and I lay them one over the other, there are so many similarities between the two that I cannot say definitively that this is for sure what it is. But when you see things like this little mound coming up in the middle, or the way these five arms kind of stick out, you know, it's, in my book, that looks pretty darn close to me, closer than any of the other crinoids that I've come across in my research. So really, really cool. I hope that visual aid kind of helped you out a little bit. And moving on with the visual aids that I've got like that for you guys. These are some of the geodized brachiopods that I have collected. And it is really, really, really difficult to determine what kind they are just based on that little bit of a shape. So I did as best as I could. So hopefully this visual aid will kind of help you guys out. But I have a few examples here that I believe are all that same species. And you can see there are some similarities and there are some things that aren't quite exactly the same. But from what I've seen, from what's coming out of what is alleged to be the time period of these fossils, that's the closest I can come to. And then moving on, almost everything here is from Indiana. The big horn coral over there, the big cephalopod over here, those are from Kentucky. And then this piece right here, this absolutely beautiful geode, is from Illinois. And look at this side. We can see this is actually a geodized chunk of a colonial rugosa coral, very similar to the one that you see here that I collected in Indiana. This one definitely does not have any crystals inside of it, but this one has got some really, really beautiful crystals. And just a couple of last second examples I would like to show you guys, because there is so much here. But check this one out. So this is a species of crinoid that I will have a picture up on the screen for you in just a moment. But I also have a regular fossil version of what I believe to be the same species of crinoid. But look at the size of it compared to the size of this now. This is super light. I can almost guarantee that if I were to cut this open, there would be a crystal cavity inside there. But check this out. So there is a photo, an artist recreation of what they believe this looked like around the time when it was alive. So again, another prime example. I think if you look and compare those two photos, there are so many similarities between the two. And then even coming back here and looking at the top, compared to what the top of that looks like, this part here is broken off, but there's definitely some silica here where this very well could have been a continuation of a crinoid stem, which it looks like in that photo there. So super, super cool. Really, really awesome geodes. I love finding geodized fossils. I love trying to figure out what they are. Some of them, I have no clue what they are. Like, look at this one here. So many details, so much symmetry within that. I am confident that is another crinoid. There are 5 points there, like we can see. And I wasn't able to track anything down. I'm not too sure. So if you guys have any ideas, please let me know down in the comments below. But there's that one. This one here is a little harder to see, but this is a goniatite. It's sustained a little bit of damage, but imagine this kind of continuing on here. A goniatite is an earlier rendition of an ammonite. So this would be the little part that kind of came down. And this would be the opening from this side. This is the only one that I've been able to find this clear. And I really, really love it. There are some crazy geodized ammonites and things like that that are found out there in those Indiana creeks. And it's crazy. And then this is the last one I think I'm going to show you guys here. And I believe this is some sort of spiral-shelled gastropods, because we can see it kind of goes around and around. And even looking at it from the bottom, it has that shape we would expect. Whatever critter was living inside of there was either coming out of right here or right here. Really, really cool. To the untrained eye, you'd pick that up and you'd think that's just a geode, but lo and behold, it's actually a geodized fossil. Super, super awesome. And one last thing I would like to add, I would say roughly 75% of these geodized fossils, especially like these brachiopods and things like that, they're not really going to have a cavity inside. But just, I'm not sure what it is. Most of them end up just being completely solid. I do have one creek that I can go to and I can find them where they're most of the time are hollow. So maybe it just depends on the location. And that is going to wrap up our geodized fossil video for today. I really hope you enjoyed the video. I hope you learned something. I hope you had fun along the way. I know I had a lot of fun. I have a lot of fun out in the creeks looking for these things. I always try and find the geodized fossils before I even look for regular geodes. So if you've seen my collecting content, you very well could have seen any number of these things being collected out in the creeks. And if you are new to the channel and this is the first video of mine that you are watching, I really hope that you consider subscribing and ringing that bell so you stay notified on all future uploads and updates, because I've always got content coming to the channel. But until then, have a great day and I'll see everybody later.